Well, thank you, Gary, for organizing this this meeting, and also to Myers for his fascinating speech. Of course, as a physicist, I agree with many statements he made, which I will not mention here because it would be boring. But of course, with some of the problems you mentioned, I have somewhat different views. So let me start with one thing. I think we could avoid many problems if we could agree, which will not be possible, on what is truth in science. And with science, I always mention natural sciences and physicists. I mean, in science, we say truth is only a phenomenon which can be reproduced. If somebody comes and says, yesterday I made an invention, they ask him, repeat it today, and he says, today doesn't work, I tell him, forget it. So reproducibility is one of the basic elements of truth in science, which is probably certainly true in many in all natural sciences. I don't know whether it's true in philosophy, I doubt, or sociology. I hope it's also true, at least in part, in economy. It's certainly not true in religion, where truth comes from other areas. In fact, when I discussed this problem once with John Paul, we agreed immediately that truth in science, in religion, is different, and therefore there cannot be a conflict. That's one thing. The second point is, I think some people claim that studying nature is boring because we are just unveiling a curtain from a picture which exists. I think it's not true. Real creativity comes in sciences, physics in particular, by creating the proper, I would call it variables. In the discussions today, would say the conceptual systems. Once you have the right conceptual systems, then it's relatively easy to formulate laws of nature and so on. I could give you many examples. But one point where maybe I do not agree completely with Myers is, forming these concepts is certainly the main point of creativity, but it's not a one go, I think. Certainly, we all have had this great experience of a heureka, but this forming new concepts, I think, is a continuous process and requires a continuous exchange of ideas between what I would call experiments, so phenomenology and thought. And only a combination of the two provides this continuous process to create new concepts. Of course, in science, concepts should be as unambiguous as possible. Of course, there are other fields where ambiguity is a beauty. In poetry, poetry lives from the ambiguity of different words, so their ambiguity is fine. But if you have a scientific discussion, I think we should insist on the clear definition of concepts. And if we would agree on that, on the definition of some words, I think many of the conflicts we are discussing would disappear. But that might be difficult, of course. Another problem is, usually there's a completely wrong concept in public, maybe also among scientists, how science progresses. And media always talk about revolutions. To my mind, a revolution is something which gets rid of things. That is not true in science. Mr. Einstein has been mentioned several times today already. So when special relativity came in, it did not mean that Newtonian physics was wrong. We realized that Newtonian physics is right for certain domains of physics, in particular when we have to do with small velocities of bodies, small compared to the velocity of light. And if you go to higher velocities, we have to go to special relativity. But so Newtonian physics is a special limit of the more general system of special relativity. And there maybe I do not completely agree with Myers. You said changing from one conceptual system is a big, big problem. For physicists, it's not. I mean, to going from relativistic physics to neutron of physics and vice versa is no problem at all. And we have many other concepts where we learn to change. And I wouldn't be surprised that it's really a problem for mathematicians. I think you change from rational numbers to irrational numbers without any big problems in mind. Okay, the final point. I think, Ivana, I still have not completely understood what deep thought is. If it really means a breakthrough by a genius sitting alone in his office, and that is still the prototype of a scientist or public, Mr. Einstein. Mr. Einstein is sitting in his office, thinking deeply, and resolving all puzzles. I think that's not how it works. Even Einstein was depending on new phenomena which had been discovered at that time, and he was exchanging many things with other people. So he was not the lonely wolf as is usually depicted. And therefore, I think the change of paradigm certainly is one of the big advances in progress in understanding the world. But I think establishing new paradigms, and I think is this continuous process with a continuous exchange between phenomenology and thought. Thank you. That's all I want to say.